morning, everyone, and welcome to this service on Good Friday as we mark the final events in Jesus' life on earth and his suffering and sacrifice for us on the cross. Our service this morning will proceed mostly unannounced, and we ask at the end of the service if you would please leave the church in silence. Please be seated.
In the prophet Isaiah, we read these words that foretold what would happen to Jesus, the Messiah. He was despised and rejected by others, a man of suffering and acquainted with grief, and as one from whom others hide their faces. He was despised, and we held him of no account. But he was wounded for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the punishment that made us whole, and by his bruises we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have all turned to our own way, and the Lord has laid on him the sins of us all. Let us pray. Our loving and heavenly Father, we come before you this day with awe and wonder, as this day represents how completely you love us. Despite our unworthiness, despite our sinfulness, despite our wayward ways and our failure to walk in your way, you sent Jesus, who willingly suffered and died on our behalf. But Lord, we confess to you that we don't want to have to deal with the gruesome details of Jesus' suffering. Please forgive us for our own selfishness, Lord. Forgive us for our selfish desire to not be made to feel uncomfortable or have to hear or think about things that are unpleasant. Remind us of all Jesus suffered was real, that he suffered as a man, as a human being, and that none of what he had to endure was made any easier by being your son. His pain was real. His suffering was real. His death was real. Confront us this day with the reality of the crucifixion and with the reality that it was for the burden of our sins, for it is only in understanding Jesus' suffering that we come to truly appreciate his sacrifice for each and every one of us, and it is in his name we offer this prayer. Amen.
We'll now sing together When I Survey the Wondrous Cross. It was 2 days before the Passover and the festival of unleavened bread. The chief priests and the scribes were looking for a way to arrest Jesus by stealth and kill him, for they said,
not during the festival, or there may be a riot among the people.
While Jesus was at Bethany in the house of Simon the leper, as he sat at the table, a woman came with an alabaster jar of very costly ointment of nard. And she broke open the jar and poured the ointment on his head. But some were there who said to one another in anger,
"Why was the ointment wasted in this way? For this ointment could have been sold for more than 300 denarii and the money given to the poor."
And they scolded her. But Jesus said,
"Let her alone. Why do you trouble her? She has performed a good service for me. For you always have the poor with you, and you can show kindness to them whenever you wish, but you will not always have me. She has done what she could. She has anointed my body beforehand for its burial. Truly, I tell you, wherever the good news is proclaimed in the whole world, what she has done will be told in remembrance of her."
Then Judas Iscariot, who was one of the 12, went to the chief priests in order to betray him to them. When they heard it, they were greatly pleased and promised to give him money. So he began to look for an opportunity to betray Jesus. On the first day of unleavened bread, when the Passover lamb is sacrificed, his disciples said to him,
"Where do you want us to go and make the preparations for you to eat the Passover?"
So he sent two of his disciples, saying to them,
"Go into the city, and a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him. And wherever he enters, say to the owner of the house, 'The teacher asks, where is my guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples?' He will show you a large room upstairs, furnished and ready. Make preparations for us there."
So the disciples set out and went to the city and found everything as he had told them, and they prepared the Passover meal. When it was evening, he came with the 12, and when they had taken their places and were eating, Jesus said,
"Truly I tell you, one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me."
They began to be distressed and say to him one after another,
"Surely not I."
He said to them,
"It is one of the 12, one who is dipping bread into the bowl with me. For the Son of Man goes as it is written of him, but woe to that one by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better for that one not to have been born."
While they were eating, he took a loaf of bread, and after blessing it, he broke it and gave it to them and said,
"Take, this is my body."
Then he took a cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it to them, and all of them drank from it. He said to them,
"This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many. Truly I tell you, I will never again drink of the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God."
When they had sung the hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives, and Jesus said to them,
"You will all become deserters, for it is written, 'I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered.' But after I am raised up, I will go before you to Galilee."
Peter said to him,
"Even though all become deserters, I will not."
Jesus said to him,
"Truly I tell you, this day, this very night, before the cock crows twice, you will deny me three times."
But Peter said vehemently,
"Even though I must die with you, I will not deny you."
And all of them said the same.
How dear.
They went to a place called Gethsemane, and Jesus said to his disciples, "Sit here while I pray." He took with him Peter and James and John and began to be distressed and agitated, and then said to them,
"I am deeply grieved, even to death. Remain here and keep awake."
And going a little farther, he threw himself on the ground and prayed that, if it were possible, the hour might pass from him. He said,
"Abba, Father, for you all things are possible. Remove this cup from me, yet not what I want, but what you want."
He came and found them sleeping, and he said to Peter,
"Simon, are you asleep? Could you not keep awake 1 hour? Keep awake and pray that you may not come into the time of trial. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak."
And again he went away and prayed, saying the same words. And once more he came and found them sleeping, for their eyes were very heavy, and they did not know what to say to him. He came a third time and said to them,
"Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? Enough. The hour has come. The Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up. Let us be going. See, my betrayer is at hand."
Immediately, while he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived, and with him there was a crowd with swords and clubs, from the chief priests, the scribes, and the elders. Now the betrayer had given them a sign, saying, "The one I will kiss is the man. Arrest him and lead him away under guard." So when he came, he went up to Jesus at once and said, "Rabbi," and kissed him. Then they laid hands on him and arrested him. But one of those who stood near drew his sword and struck the slave of the high priest, cutting off his ear. Then Jesus said to them,
"Have you come out with swords and clubs to arrest me as though I were a bandit? Day after day I was with you in the temple teaching, and you did not arrest me, but let the scriptures be fulfilled."
All of them deserted him and fled. A certain young man was following him, wearing nothing but a linen cloth. They caught hold of him, but he left the linen cloth and ran off naked. They took Jesus to the high priest, and all the chief priests, the elders, and the scribes were assembled. Peter had followed him at a distance right into the courtyard of the high priest, and he was sitting with the guards, warming himself at the fire. Now the chief priests and the whole council were looking for testimony against Jesus to put him to death, but they found none. For many gave false testimony against him, and their testimony did not agree. Some stood up and gave false testimony against him, saying,
"We heard him say, 'I will destroy this temple that is made with hands, and in 3 days I will build another not made with hands.'"
But even on this point, their testimony did not agree. Then the high priest stood up before them and asked Jesus,
"Have you no answer? What is that they testify against you?"
But he was silent and did not answer. Again, the high priest asked him,
"Are you the Messiah, the Son of the Blessed One?"
Jesus said,
"I am. And you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of the power and coming with the clouds of heaven."
Then the high priest tore his clothes and said,
"Why do we still need witnesses? You have heard his blasphemy. What is your decision?"
All of them condemned him as deserving death. Some began to spit on him, to blindfold him, and to strike him, saying to him, "Prophesy." The guards also took him over and beat him. While Peter was below in the courtyard, one of the servant girls of the high priest came by. When she saw Peter warming himself, she stared at him and said,
"You also were with Jesus, the man from Nazareth."
But he denied it, saying,
I do not know or understand what you're talking about."
And he went out into the forecourt. Then the cock crowed, And the servant girl, on seeing him, began again to say to the bystanders,
"This man is one of them."
But again he denied it. Then after a little while, the bystanders again said to Peter,
"Certainly you are one of them, for you are a Galilean."
But he began to curse, and he swore an oath,
"I do not know this man you're talking about."
At that moment, the cock crowed for the second time. Then Peter remembered that Jesus had said to him,
"Before the cock crows twice, you will deny me three times."
And Peter broke down and wept. You may remain seated as we sing "Beneath the Cross of Jesus." As soon as it was morning, the chief priests held a consultation with the elders and scribes and the whole council. They bound Jesus, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate. Pilate asked Jesus,
"Are you the king of the Jews?"
He answered him,
"You say so."
Then the chief priests accused him of many things. Pilate asked him again,
"Have you no answer? See how many charges they bring against you."
But Jesus made no further reply, so that Pilate was amazed. Now at the festival, Pilate used to release a prisoner for them, anyone for whom they asked. Now a man called Barabbas was in prison with the rebels who had committed murder during the insurrection. So the crowd came and began to ask Pilate to do for them according to his custom. Then he answered them,
"Do you want me to release for you the king of the Jews?"
For he realized that it was out of jealousy that the chief priests had handed Jesus over. But the chief priests stirred up the crowd to have him release Barabbas for them instead. Pilate spoke to them again,
"Then what do you wish me to do with the man you call the king of the Jews?"
They shouted back,
"Crucify him!"
Pilate asked them,
"Why? What evil has he done?"
But they shouted all the more,
"Crucify him!"
So Pilate, wishing to satisfy the crowd, released Barabbas for them, and after flogging Jesus, he handed him over to be crucified. Then the soldiers led Jesus into the courtyard of the palace, that is, the governor's headquarters, and they called together the whole cohort. And they clothed him in a purple cloak, and after twisting some thorns into a crown, they put it on him, and they began saluting him.
Hail, King of the Jews!
They struck his head with a reed, spat upon him, and knelt down in homage to him. After mocking him, they stripped him of the purple cloak and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him out to crucify him. They compelled a passerby who was coming in from the country to carry his cross. It was Simon of Cyrene, the father of Alexander and Rufus. Then they brought Jesus to the place called Golgotha, which means the place of a skull. And they offered him wine mixed with myrrh, but he did not take it. And they crucified him and divided his clothes among them, casting lots to decide what each should take. It was 9 o'clock in the morning when they crucified him. The inscription of the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews." And with him they crucified two bandits, one on his right hand and one on his left. Those who passed by derided him, shaking their heads and saying,
"Aha! You who would destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself and come down from the cross."
In the same way, the chief priests, along with the scribes, were also mocking him among themselves and saying,
"He saved others. He cannot save himself. Let the Messiah, the King of Israel, come down from the cross now, so that we may see and believe."
Those who were crucified with him also taunted him. When it was noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. At 3 o'clock, Jesus cried out with a loud voice,
"Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani,"
which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" When some of the bystanders heard it, they said,
"Listen, he is calling for Elijah."
And someone ran, filled a sponge with sour wine, put it on a stick, and gave it to him to drink, saying,
"Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to take him down."
Shining, and the curtain of the temple was torn in two.
and one voice surrendered.
Father, into your hands I commit my spirit.
When evening had come, and since it was the day of preparation, that is, the day before the Sabbath, Joseph of Arimathea, a respected member of the council, who was also himself waiting expectantly for the kingdom of God, went boldly to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then Pilate wondered if Jesus were already dead, and summoning the centurion, he asked him whether he had been dead for some time. When he learned from the centurion that Jesus was dead, he granted the body to Joseph. Then Joseph bought a linen cloth, and taking down the body, wrapped it in the linen cloth and laid it in a tomb that had been hewn out of the rock. Then he rolled a stone against the door of the tomb. Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Joseph, saw where the body was laid.